E is one of the most important numbers in all of math, but what exactly is it? Let's explore E in five levels, ranging from two practical scenarios to E's role in calculus and beyond. For level one, let's see how Jacob Bernoulli discovered E by looking at compound interest. Let's say you invest $1, and your investment has an amazing 100% interest per year. If the interest is calculated at the end of 1 year, then you'll get $1 in interest. So your account has doubled from $1 to $2. But what happens if your interest is calculated every 6 months? For a 6 month period, you'll get half as much interest, 50%. So after 6 months, you get paid 50 cents, bringing your balance to $1.50. Then in the next 6 months, you gain 50% of this amount, which is 75 cents. So your total at the end of the year is 225. You get an extra 25 cents, 50% of the 50 cents of interest paid in the first period. We can write this as $1 times 1.5 times 1.5, or $1 times 1.5 squared. What if you're paid 4 times per year? Now you get 25% interest each period for 4 periods during the year. You start with $1 and then multiply by 1.25 4 times, so 1.25 to the fourth. At the end of the year, you have around $2.44. We see the more often the interest is compounded, the more interest you'll earn. If interest is compounded n times per year, then your ending balance is $1 times 1 plus 1 over n to the power n. The 100% interest is divided by n to get the interest for each period, and then we multiply by this factor n times 1 for each period. We can plug in n equals 12 to see your balance if the interest is compounded monthly, or n equals 365 for daily compounding. We notice there's diminishing returns after a while. Switching from yearly to quarterly or monthly makes a significant difference, but going from daily to millions of times per year barely makes a difference at all. In the limit as n approaches infinity, this quantity converges to the number e, about 2.71828. E represents the ending balance of an account that started with $1 that gained 100% interest compounded continuously over the year. For level two, let's see how E relates to probability. Say you're designing a slot machine. The player will have a 1 over n chance of winning, but will get to play n times. If n equals 2, the player wins half the time, but only gets to play twice. If n equals 10, the probability of winning is 1 out of 10, but the player will play 10 times. This way, the player wins on average 1 time, no matter what the value of n is. But what's the probability the player will lose all n times? Since there's a 1 out of n chance of winning on each attempt, the probability of losing is 1 minus 1 over n. Since the player plays the game n times, and these attempts are independent, we multiply the probability of losing n times to get 1 minus 1 over n to the power n. Plotting these values, we see the probability of losing all n attempts is increasing as n goes to infinity. But there's a limit here, and the expression looks very similar to our limit definition of e. This limit turns out to be 1 over e, which we can find with a little calculus. For level 3, let's look at the role of e in calculus. We've seen how to define e as a limit. We can also define e by thinking about derivatives. Let's look at the function 2 to the x. If we find its derivative when x equals 0, the instantaneous slope at that point, it's a bit less than 1. If we find the derivative of 3 to the x when x equals 0, now the slope is a bit more than 1. As the value of the base of the function increases, the slope also increases. So somewhere between a base of 2 and 3, there is a value that will have derivative exactly equal to 1. And that value is e. We could also define e by thinking about an integral. If we look at the integral of the function 1 over x, let's find the area under the curve between 1 and 2. This area is a bit less than 1. If we find the area under that same function between 1 and 3, now the area is a bit more than 1. So for some value between 2 and 3, this area will be exactly 1. And again, that value is e. We can also find the Taylor series for the function e to the x. We already know the derivative of e to the x at x equals 0 is 1. To find the derivative everywhere, we can use the limit definition. we take the limit as h approaches 0 of e to the x plus h minus e to the x all over h. We can factor out e to the x, and we're left with the limit as h approaches 0 of e to the h minus 1 all over h. E to the 0 is 1, so that's the same as e to the h minus e to the 0 over h. This is the definition of the derivative of e to the x at x equals 0, which we just said is 1. So the derivative of e to the x is just itself. And no matter how many derivatives we take, we always get e to the x. And when we evaluate at x equals 0, we always get 1. So the Taylor series for e to the x has this nice form, giving us another expression for e. Understanding e, or really any mathematical concept, requires us to actively engage with new ideas and solve problems. A free and easy way to do this is with Brilliant, the sponsor of this video. Brilliant allows you to learn through exploration, with thousands of interactive lessons in programming, math, data analysis, and AI. Brilliant helps you build your knowledge from the ground up by completing fun lessons in a few spare minutes each day. You'll build your critical thinking skills through problem solving, not memorizing. For example, instead of just reading about Bayes' theorem, you engage with the ideas, updating probabilities given new information. Brilliant's course, How Technology Works, takes you inside the tech we use every day, helping you explore how it actually works. You'll explore the math behind what makes a password weak or strong, how your phone can pinpoint your location, and how video compression enables modern video streaming. You can even play with transistors to learn about computer memory. To try everything Brilliant has to offer for free for a full 30 days, visit brilliant.org/drshawn or click on the link in the description. You'll also get 20% off an annual premium subscription. For level 4, let's see how E is hidden in Pascal's triangle. Pascal's triangle starts with a row of 1 and then a row of 1, 1. For the following rows, each value is found by adding the two values above each position. We can imagine there are zeros beyond the edge of the triangle. So how could we possibly get E from this? The idea is to multiply the values in each row. Let's call these row products Sn. It turns out the entries in Pascal's triangle are combinations or binomial coefficients. I have another video all about Pascal's triangle that gets into the details of that. The kth entry in the nth row of the triangle is n choose k, which has this formula. We can use this to find the product of an entire row of Pascal's triangle. In the numerator, we have an n factorial for each of the n plus 1 factors. Then in the denominator, we'll have each factorial from 0 factorial to n factorial show up exactly twice, once in each position. So we can write Sn like this. Then we can divide two successive rows. Most of the factors in these two products will cancel out, leaving just an n plus 1 factorial squared in the denominator. Then we can cancel those with two of the n plus 1 factorials in the numerator. Now we're left with n plus 1 factorial to the n over n factorial to the n plus 1. All of the factors in the numerator will cancel except for the n plus 1s, leaving n plus 1 to the n. In the denominator, we'll cancel n of each value, leaving just 1 of each. That's n factorial. That's a nice formula for these ratios. To get E, there's just one more step. Let's take the ratios of these ratios. This will be Sn plus 1 over Sn divided by Sn over Sn minus 1. The factorials cancel out, leaving just n in the denominator. We can combine this with the rest of the n's to get n plus 1 to the n over n to the n. Then rewriting this, we get 1 plus 1 over n to the n. What happens as n goes to infinity? We get e. This is the exact same limit form of e we saw from compound interest. For level 5, let's look at another probability question that lets us easily simulate the value of e. Say we start with independent random variables, each chosen uniformly between 0 and 1. x1 is between 0 and 1, and then x1 plus x2 is between 0 and 2, and so on. Eventually, we'll add up enough of these values to get a sum greater than 1. On average, how many terms is it going to take? We can start by finding the probabilities. The probability it takes 2 terms is the probability that x1 plus x2 is greater than 1. The point x1, x2 lies in this unit square. The part of the square where the sum is greater than 1 is this upper triangle, which has area 1/2. So there's a 1/2 probability that with just two terms, the sum exceeds 1. What about the probability that we need three terms? This means that x1 plus x2 is less than or equal to 1, and x1 plus x2 plus x3 is greater than 1. We know the probability that x1 plus x2 is less than or equal to 1 is 1/2. Then there's two possibilities. Either the sum of all three of them is also less than or equal to 1, or it's more than 1. We can subtract the part that we don't want, that the sum of the three is still less than 1. To summarize this technique, the probability it takes n terms to get the sum above 1 is equal to the probability that the first n minus 1 terms add up to less than 1, minus the probability that the first n terms add up to less than 1. We just need to solve for the probabilities of this specific form, and then we'll know all the probabilities for this problem. It turns out that the probability the sum of the first n terms is at most 1 is 1 over n factorial. Let's see a geometric explanation for this. When n equals 2, the area of this triangle is 1/2. When n equals 3, now we have a pyramid. The volume of a pyramid is 1/3 times the area of the base times the height. The height in our case is just 1, but where did that 1/3 come from? Imagine taking a slice of the pyramid at height z. The triangular slice has measurements x times 1 minus z and y times 1 minus z. So the area is xy 1 minus z squared. In other words, it's the area of the base times 1 minus z squared. To find the volume, we integrate over these slices, integrating z from 0 to 1. We get the area of the base times 1/3. The 3 came from the power rule for integrals. Since we're transitioning from 2 to 3 dimensions, that constant is 3. So the probability x1 plus x2 plus x3 is less than or equal to 1 is equal to the previous probability, which was 1/2, times by 1/3 to get 1/6. Similarly, when we go to n equals 4, we get the same probability multiplied by 1/4. That's 1 over 4 factorial. And for a general n, the probability is 1 over n factorial. Now we can plug these in to find the probability that it takes n uniform random variables for the sum to first pass 1. The probability is 1 over n minus 1 factorial minus 1 over n factorial, which we can write as n minus 1 over n factorial. Lastly, we find the expected value of the number of terms it takes. It takes at least 2 terms, so the sum starts at 2. We multiply each value by the probability of it occurring. After simplifying, we get the sum from 2 to infinity of 1 over n minus 2 factorial. We can re-index to get the sum from 0 to infinity of 1 over k factorial. This is e. So the expected number of independent uniform random variables we have to add up for the sum to be above 1 is equal to e. Which is your favorite representation of e? And maybe you know some other ways to represent it. Let us know in the comments. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.